Hey everyone, welcome to my channel, Books, Girls, and Purrs. Today I'm going to be talking about episode 6 of Interview with a Vampire, Like Angels Put in Hell by God. But before we talk about the episode, just keep in mind, if you have not watched all these episodes 1 through 6, and you haven't read the books, Interview the Vampire all the way to Merrick, like I think that's like the 10th book or something like that, or Blackwood Farm, I think that's the one I read last. Don't watch this. This is for people that have read the books, okay? Because I will spoil it. I'm going to talk about some ideas that I have and probably just, you know, me putting the tinfoil hat on. But just in case I happen to be right, you don't want to be spoiled, so. For readers only, alright? Alright, so the episode opens with Louis in recovery after being attacked by Lestat. And he mentions that he wakes up thinking about the feeling and that moment of being dropped from the sky. And I mean, I watched this twice, okay? Every episode I watch twice so I can make notes. You know, first time, just enjoy it. Second time, just try to think about what's going on. And I realized that the action of falling is something that he remembers so severely, but that's exactly what his brother Paul went through. And so I figure that's got to be a terrible thing to be someone that's potentially never going to die and to have that on your mind, especially when we know as a reader, as a viewer, that Paul meant so much to Louis, to have that on his mind. Yeah, that's, anyways, I kind of go off and get romantic and overthink things, so that was on my mind. The next scene is in Dubai, and Daniel is receiving a transfusion, and this is another tinfoil hat moment, because Daniel needs treatment, right? He has some version of Parkinson's, and what I'm wondering is he just getting his medication for Parkinson's, or is the doctor giving him possibly some of Louis's blood, not like actual blood, but like a, I don't know, like a transfused version of that. The only reason why I bring this up is memory has come into play throughout the series, and by the end of the episode we do have that reveal and mystery, but I'll get there later. But that's what I'm wondering. I'm wondering if the fact that he's tapping into memories does not have to only do with how he's spending time with Luis and Rashid, but that something else nefarious is going on with his medication. That's just an idea, but I wanted to bring that up. The other thing that they discuss is Lestat's like cloud gift, and what Lestat is capable of in terms of powers and what Luis is capable of. And it's so hard to tell with the show, because there have been things changed as far as like power capabilities for vampires. For instance, there's so much, as you know, that Luis really couldn't do as a vampire in the books, and in the show he just has more capabilities, which I'm all for. I feel like it enriches a story, but that's part of that. So I forget where I was going. I just feel like I can never tell how much of an unreliable narrator Luis really is, but that's kind of the point of the book itself, right? Interview the Vampire, is that we're seeing through his lens, only to find out later in the books Lestat has like a different point of view. Anyways, I just wanted to keep that in mind. So the next scene is back at Luis's home with Claudia, And he's basically having his version of physical therapy recovery, where Claudia releases a goat and he has to chase a goat. And it was actually this really sweet, endearing, and sad all at the same time moment of Claudia and Louis supporting each other and being a family. And it's almost like these montage of moments of them being together at home. And I liked that two things stuck out to me. Louise is reading a book at some point, and I don't know the name of the book, I couldn't see it, but the chapter he's reading is on marriage, and I felt like that was meant to be like a reflection of maybe how Louis sees his relationship with Lestat. Maybe he's examining what their relationship is, because what they have is very much a dysfunctional marriage, is how I think of it. So, and the other thing is, Claudia was reading Emily Dickinson, who had her own very interesting life herself. So I felt like that was another reflection, right, of Claudia in a way that I really enjoyed. At this point, Lestat comes in the picture, and you realize that over a 6-year period, he's coming by and he's trying to give Louis gifts as an apology for how he treated him. I mean, that's 6 years. That's like dedication, that's stalking. And he really is handling it in the only way that Lestat really can, which is through like material things, right? Which has been Lestat's problem all along, is that instead of making like true, vulnerable, intimate connections, he tries to fix things or maybe show the way that he loves, maybe that's just his love language, by doing these like material gestures. And they're just so ineffectual. It's never worked, you know? Like, for instance, when Luis brings up just like the, how do I say it? The racism that is like hurled his way, and how Lestat's way of like addressing it is like, oh, let's go to an opera. Like, it's just not gonna do anything, you know? And also, it's really in service of Lestat. He's not even thinking about what Louis likes, which I've brought up before. But so yeah, that doesn't work. And what I really like about these rejections of Lestat's gifts, I mean, it ranges from like sad to funny. But we also see this dynamic, right, of Claudia truly being a big sister. At some point, Lestat says about Louis, like, your silence is cruel and you're never cruel. But I feel like that's why Claudia is there, right? She's there to be the big sister. She's there to be the cruel one. She's there to throw keys at Lestat. She's there to scratch the car with her sharp nails. And I just really enjoy that dynamic, you know? At some point, finally, Lestat hits a nerve with Louis, right? And he makes a song for Louis, an original. And I wish I could put it the way that Jacob Anderson said it. He said something like a perfect flaw. I know that's not how quite how he said it. Oh, premeditated, right? Premeditated flaw. And that's the fact that Lestat's lover, Antoinette, is also singing on the album for Louis. And this brings me to the next moment, right? Louis swims across the Mississippi to hunt down Lestat with all his anger at him for what happened to him. And he feels slighted, right, that this woman is also on this vulnerable gesture. And here's the thing, as angry as Luis is, I love the acting between him and Jacob Anderson and Sam Reed, because Sam Reed's Lestat as soon as he sees Louis come in, he's already giving the subtlest of smiles on his face. It just cracked me up. I like had to rewind it. Like, I get it. He's in the sheets just standing there. But I was really just looking at his face and how there is this, like, hope. I get, is that what it is? Tell me what you think. Like, hope and excitement that Louis is there, that what he did, his slight, that his pushing of Louis's button actually worked. And so, of course, they passionately get back together, kick Antoinette out of her own home. And, like, Louis causes Lestat pain, but then they're making love. And what I thought was, I can't help it. What was hilarious about this moment is that I think Lestat smiles and he did what he did because we also have to reflect on Louis's nature. Louis is someone that pulled a knife out on his own brother, who he says he's has a very tight bond with, possibly more than his other siblings. And so it's that viciousness that Lestat fell in love with, you know, from the beginning, that became entranced with, became obsessed with. And so I just feel like there's parts of Louis that Lestat understands and sees that I don't really know if I almost feel like it pierces the point of view of Louis, right? Trying to always come off like he's under the spell of Lestat in a way. And it might be true, but I also feel like he could be equally vicious. Anyway, so that was kind of just on my mind. All right, so the next scene is Louis is at home with Lestat and Claudia. And this is definitely like a reconciliation moment, but it's like a moment where Lestat has to be incredibly vulnerable. Like, let it all go, let his guard down, right? And because where else can he go? Like, how else could he make this work when the dynamic went so wrong? Claudia and Louis lay down some ground rules, right? Lestat has to kill Antoinette. Lestat has to tell the truth. It has to change. Like, Claudia has to be equals. And that's definitely not the dynamic that the show started out with. And one of the things that was lingering over Louis's head, and I think a lot of readers, not me, but I know one of the theories was that Lestat had something to do with Paul's death. And so Louis asks Lestat if he had something to do with it. And he seems to very genuinely say that he would never hurt Louis's brother. But here's the deal. Lestat is the same person that dropped Louis from the sky, that took him above the clouds and dropped him. So I want to believe Lestat. And actually, I read the books several times. And I even read an interview with a vampire recently. I didn't get the feeling that Lestat had anything to do with Paul's death, but it could have just gone over my head because that's definitely a theory that's been out there. And so I wonder when the second or third season rolls around, if that is still going to hold as a truth or if that's going to change. Because if Lestat's answer is only, I would never do that to your brother, I don't think it's enough. Like, I don't think we're at a point where we could 100% trust Lestat, you know. He's a person that says that he's so in love with Louis, but he also violently dropped him from the sky. And that just really sticks out to me. So once again, the trio's together. And as time passes, you see there is a bit of a, do you want to call it an Easter egg or a nod to the Mayfair witches? Because they step out of their home, and there's like a circle, and like I don't know if it's witchcraft or voodoo, but there's got to be some sort of witchcraft involved. So to me, I felt like that was a nod to the Mayfair witches. And also across the street, you actually see some women scuttle off. So I don't know if they're Mayfair witches or if they're just meant to be placed there to just show how people are growing more and more concerned that this family is not aging. So as time goes on, Louis just keeps playing peacemaker between him, Lestat, and Claudia, because Claudia and Lestat are ultimately so much alike that they just bump heads all the time, and neither one of them are really willing to relent. You know, Lestat says he's making an effort, but it's always with like an air of superiority. And at this point in time, we find out that according to Lestat, he's killed Antoinette. He gives a paper, a newspaper, and Antoinette's finger with a ring to Louis and Claudia. But as soon as that moment happened, I already didn't believe it. I don't know why. I just think Lestat has always liked his toys, if you will, and so I just didn't think he had actually killed her, or that it was even her finger. Something that I forgot to bring up is that when Luis is playing peacemaker between Lestat and Claudia, he does tell Claudia something about, like, oh, this family endures. And that's definitely a theme, not just in this episode, like, it's very prevalent in this episode, but throughout the show, it's about enduring. And so I just feel like that's a terrible way to live, right? I think that Louis at some point tells Claudia to endure. Like, they're all kind of saying we must endure to some extent. You know, that's part of their dynamic. Enduring almost seems like they're just putting up with each other. And I think Claudia starts to see that enduring is just not enough. And that's why I love a moment like with Lestat mentioning how the fireplace should be fixed. And Claudia is really good at snapping back and saying, you know what? No, we don't get rid of the damage. We keep it so that like it doesn't happen again. I can't say it as well as she did, but it was like such an incredible moment, and Lestat just has to take it, right? So the next scene is at a bench, which is definitely the bench that you see throughout the show, right? Even when it's just Lestat and Louis, and as their family grows, they always end up at that bench. And when Lestat leaves, he turns to Louis and like whispers an "I love you," and he gives like a little bit of a smile. And so it's so wild that Louis is a character that also, although he's brokenhearted for how he's been treated by Lestat, he still genuinely loves him. You know, it's still there. It's just sad. And at some point, I think after that is when, actually before that, I totally forgot. Claudia and Louis find out that, I was right, Antoinette is still alive. She's still Louis's plaything. But we also know that I think at this point that Lestat has promised her something. And I'm assuming that he's promised her to become a vampire because in the books, he did make a vampire. It just like happened like off screen, and it was like subtly hinted at, but his name was like, you know, Antoine or something. So the character of Antoinette is like a gender flip character, if you could call it that. Gender swapped, whatever. Either way, like in the books, it's like further on from where they're at in the show, but Antoine comes looking for Lestat and Ken, but I'll get to that later. Back at the bench, Lestat says his goodbyes. Louis and Claudia know that he's probably just gonna go off and see Antoinette, and Claudia decides that she's leaving, and she's been trying to talk Louis into it, but he just doesn't have the strength, you know? He just seems so connected to Lestat. He just doesn't have, he doesn't have the will or the strength to leave yet. And so this time around, he really does let Claudia go on her own, and they part ways. And what's really beautiful in this moment, I didn't realize the first time I watched it, but I noticed the second time, is that when they hug, the music is Louis and his family's theme song, I guess you could say. You know, there's like a certain song that gets played when he's around his family, and it happens again at this moment where he departs from Claudia. And I thought that was really beautiful. It really sends a signal that Claudia is home for him, that Claudia is his family, and that this moment is very much like losing his sister all over again. From that moment on, we go to back to Dubai with the interview, and we're informed that this is right where the original interview, the interview that everyone's read in the actual book, ended. So that's pretty cool to know that actually it's Claudia trying to get away for a second time, is when the original interview ended, and that Louis attacked Daniel because Daniel wanted to become a vampire. And at this point, Louis kind of like flippantly offers to make Daniel a vampire. And I don't know if he's truly being genuine or if he's saying it because he knows Daniel will say no. But Rashid does not like that he said that. He heard that and he clearly looks offended, but he's trying to conceal it. And then he excuses himself. And while Daniel Malloy and Louis are talking, Louis informs the interviewer and the viewer that he once again is feeling a suicidal ideation, that he's thinking he'll step into the sun and that'll be it now that Claudia's left. And the only reason, or o yeah, the only reason that he's tethered to this life is because he doesn't want to do that to Claudia, which is really telling because he clearly does not even have any thought as to how Lestat would feel about him dying. And from there, as soon as Claudia feels like she's finally escaped while she's on a train, hidden all the way in the back, wherever she could find a spot to hide with suitcases and pets, Lestat shows up, and it's really horrifying and yet disturbingly humorous all at the same time because he's playing with the head of the person that he's murdered to find Claudia. And although this moment takes like a different form, I thought it was very much in the vein of the books. When Claudia's mom gets found by Lestat in the books, and Lestat dances with a dead corpse, which happened not only in the books, but it happened in the 1996 movie. And so I thought, well, this is just as grotesque and horrifying of a moment that really worked really well. I didn't know how to feel. It was like all over the place. So yeah, he really comes in and takes control of the situation, and he even tells Claudia, "You have to come back because he's in a worse state than he was before," which means that he's somehow been tipped off into knowing that Louis has suicidal ideation. And for him, he went through a period of what? 7 years of being with Louis when Claudia was gone the first time, and not only did Louis make himself miserable, he treated Lestat so bad, emotionally and verbally. And I think that in Lestat's sick, sick way, he's doing this to protect Louis, to keep him going, because I think he knows that once Claudia's gone, there's really nothing holding on to this relationship, right? I mean, we saw that even when Claudia was being made, she was just like this band-aid for their relationship that had always been tumultuous. So Lestat, being the terrible person that he is, that we all know and love, brings up Bruce and really just like pushes Claudia's buttons. But he's such a hypocrite because he even tells her, oh, you know, this family doesn't keep secrets and you're running off. And he's rattling off all these other examples. But he's the same way. He's the one that just cannot be honest. I don't know what it is. I don't know if he's a pathological liar or what. But he's just has this, like, wall around him. And there's something that also visually worked really well in this moment. And that's when Lestat lets a dog out and lets the dog lick the blood off his fingers and then puts the dog back in the cage. And he even says out loud, back in your cage. And I feel like that's exactly symbolically what he's doing to Claudia. He is just finding another way to keep her in captivity. And in this scene, there's a great nod to foreshadowing, because Lestat threatens Claudia. And what does he say? He says, I'll turn your bones to ash. And any of you readers out there are gonna know that if you know the arc of Claudia, exactly what that means. The next scene is at home. Louis gets the strength to leave the bench and go home and have another day with Lestat day by day. And wouldn't you know it, Claudia is there. Claudia's home, and she's there to stay because Lestat is making him stay. And we also see what's going on throughout history as they don't age, as time passes by. We get these nods to what's going on. And at this moment, it's the rise of Nazi Germany, and then the war is starting. And because of everything that's happened, Lestat has put Claudia in a position to feel like there's no way out unless I beat this man at his own game. I'm going to have to be so cruel. I'm going to have to be Lestat to beat Lestat. And we see that kind of symbolically played out with a game of chess. And I love just how, like, angry Lestat gets, because it just shows how much, how much he can't handle losing, right? It's like, for someone that says he's trying, he has to dominate in all areas, right? So, and that's like no way to live. Which leads to the last scene of the episode, where are we at? We're back in Dubai, right? And Louis realizes that at some point Daniel's fallen asleep. So they let him sleep, you know, let him have a blanket and chill. And through Daniel's dreams, he thinks back to when he first met Louis in a bar, in a gay bar. And what I love about the scene is the overshot of going into the city is just like the 1996 movie with Tom Cruise and Brad Pitt. If you look at what they did in this episode and then you just go and watch the intro to the 96 movie, you're gonna see that that scene was a little bit of a nod to that movie, or at least I thought it was, and I thought that was really cool. Anyways, so Daniel meets Louis at a bar, which was so great to see Louis in, like, in a different time period, seeing like that time jump. And when they're chatting, Louis says something to the effect of, he's like questioning what Daniel has in his bag, like if he has a gun or something. And he says, "Oh, I did a bad thing once," which was really funny, and I felt like that must be a nod to what he does to Lestat. And also, oh, I kind of messed up. I forgot to mention a couple of things. But this whole section in the bar, a lot of that dialogue is ripped straight from the book. And I want to kick myself because I wanted to mention it from an earlier scene, and I forgot. But at some point, Claudia in the show tells Louis that Lestat is the father of lies, and that's also right from the book. There's a lot of moments in this specific episode where I could actually just picture like the lines in the book. It was really incredible. And then speaking of incredible, right when Louis and Daniel are gonna take off and have their interview, Rashid shows up and Lestat, no, not Lestat, Louis invites Rashid, but in this moment, you know what I noticed is that he doesn't call Rashid by his name in the sea, and also Rashid looks like the same age he is in modern current times. So I feel like Louis just kind of goes, "Hey, do you want to hang out with us?" But we don't really know who he is or his name. And again, he has not aged. So then Daniel wakes up and he's like, "What the hell?" So was this just a dream? Did this really happen? Is this some memory being recovered? Which makes me go back to thinking that maybe Louis is giving him a little bit of his blood, like some transfused version to heal his Parkinson's. That's my guess. That's my big tinfoil idea. But I don't know yet. Because also, I think like the time when the doctor is treating Daniel, Rashid like walks across into the sun. So that's why I keep thinking he might be from the Talamasca. That's what's throwing me off. Because I already thought Rashid was a totally different character when I saw the trailer. But then the episodes came out and you realize his name's Rashid, so I'm like, okay, well, I'm all wrong. But that's the end of the episode. That was a reveal about Rashid. Let me know what you think. And I really appreciate how the characters were developed in this episode, their dynamics, and to create a believability of Louis taking back a person that treated him so violently is such a delicate line to toe, and I think they did it really beautifully. All right. I can't think of anything else or any other questions. I just try to ask questions as I kind of went on. These are my notes. Let me know what you think, and I guess I'll see you later.